Hey, everybody, I have got such a good one for you today. We are doing our first chapter Friday, and today we are doing other wood. Oh, this is such a good one. This one can go in so many different categories or genres. It could be in scary, it could be in fantasy and magic, it could be in friends and family, it could be in a lot of them. At my school, I have decided to put it in the fantasy and magic. Just because I think there's more fantasy and magic in it than anything. So that's where it will be in our school. So if my kids are watching right now, it's going to be in fantasy and magic, and you will not want to miss this one. I'm going to read two chapters today because the first chapter is so very short. So I want you to kind of get a feel of the book. So we're going to do two chapters. Let me share my screen so that you can see. I'm just going to put up the book cover here so that you can see it. Let me make it big. There we go. Okay, so Other Wood by Pete Haltman. I'm going to get my glasses on so I can read. Okay, so Other Wood by Pete Haltman. The first chapter is called The Queen of the Wood. Chapter one, The Storm. Years later, people still talked about it. It came out of nowhere, they said, middle of the day, black as night, sideways rain, trees bent and twisted like blades of grass. Stewie had been just 8 years old, but he remembered the storm as if it were yesterday. Thunder you could feel in your belly. Everybody in the basement now, his mom shouted. Grandpa Zach rushed outside to close the windows on his riding cottage. Daddy, Stewie's mom called after him. I'll be fine, Grandpa Zach yelled back. He ducked into the cottage just as the first hailstones came hammering down. A clap of thunder left Stewie's ears ringing. His mom slammed the door and hustled him downstairs to the basement. Grandpa will wait out the storm in his cottage, Stewie, she told him shakily. He'll be okay. When the thunder finally stopped, Stewie and his mom came up from the basement. Outside, it looked like another world. Trees stripped bare, grass littered with leaves, twigs, and shingles, melting hailstones big as fists, hundreds of sheets of yellow paper scattered everywhere. The roof of the guest cottage was gone, torn off by the wind. They found Grandpa Zach on the floor behind his desk, curled up, arms wrapped around his belly as if he were hugging himself. Around him were scattered yellow pages covering his handwriting. His crabbed and spidery script bleeding from the rain. Gramps' eyes were open, staring sightlessly at the sodden pages. Wet gray hair scraggled across his cheek. Stewie, go back to the house, his mother said. Why? Just go. Stewie remembered that day the way he remembered nightmares, the sort of horrific slideshow, one awful image piled on top of another. He went back to the house, carrying with him the knowledge that Gramps, his best friend, was gone. The shock was so sudden and complete that he couldn't even cry. He didn't cry then, nor at Grandpa Zach's funeral 3 days later. He couldn't bear to touch the emptiness. According to the news, it hadn't been a tornado, but straight-line winds with multiple downbursts, angry clouds firing air cannons at the ground. The cottage had taken a direct hit. Half a mile away in the middle of Westdale Wood, a second downburst had toppled five tall cottonwoods to create an enormous deadfall, but no one had been there to see it. Well, that deadfall is going to be very, very important. Chapter two, Creepy Bent. The day before the storm, Stewie had discovered the fairy circle. Stewie lived with his mom and gramps at the end of Ford Lane in the largest and oldest home in Westdale, a three-story house so big they used only half the rooms. The house was gray, battleship gray, Gramps called it. Stewie's bedroom was on the third floor overlooking their small apple orchard. Their houses had been built by Stewie's great-grandfather. Stewie's mom had grown up here. Grandpa Zach had lived there his whole life. The other six houses on Ford Lane were newer, normal-sized homes with smaller lots. There were no kids his age. Stewie's best friend, Jack Kopsky, had moved away last summer. With nobody in the neighborhood to play with, Stewie mostly hung around with his mom and gramps or went off by himself to explore. On the far side of the orchard was a meadow, and beyond the meadow was Westdale Wood, 1 square mile of towering oaks, wildflower carpeted glades, glossy waist-high strands of poison ivy and May apple, prickly tangles of gooseberry, nettles, burdock, black caps, raspberries, and wild grape. There were deer and rabbits and wild turkeys, raccoons and foxes and mink, butterflies and hornet's nests, cicadas and mosquitoes, boggy places that would suck the shoes off your feet, mossy boulder-strewn ravines, impenetrable thickets of buckthorn. Stewie had explored only a small part of it. He had never been to the other side. That morning, while Gramps was in his cottage writing and his mom was in her studio painting, Stewie wandered off through the apple orchard. The apples were tiny green nubbins. Most of them would be wormy when they got bigger. Gramps didn't believe in spraying the trees. Bugs have to eat too, he'd like to say. When autumn arrived, they would salvage enough good apples for the three of them. Stewie crossed the orchard and waded through the tall grasses of the meadow. On the far side of the grassy meadow stood a grove of white-barked poplar trees. Stewie usually avoided the poplar grove. The trees grew too close together and the gaps between were choked with underbrush. But on that day, he noticed a narrow deer path leading into the grove, so he followed it. He had gone only a few yards when he came upon a treeless circle of grass. The grass was about 30 feet across and brilliant green. The grass hugged the ground as if someone had been mowing it. Stewie dropped to his knees and ran his hands over the velvety surface. He stood up and walked across the circle, his faint footprints lasting only a few seconds before the tiny blades of grass sprang back up to erase them. He looked around at the ring of tall, slender poplars pressing in as though they were spectators. It felt magical. Stewie left the grove and ran back to Gramps' mat writing cottage. The old man was hunched over his desk, puffing on a pipe and filling yet another yellow page with his memories. Even though it was a warm summer day, he was wearing the ratty wool cardigan he always called his smoking sweater. "Gramps, come see what I found. I found a fairy circle." "A fairy circle, you say?" Grandpa Zach capped his fountain pen. "In the poplar groves." "Fairies in the poplars?" he chuckled. "Come see." Grandpa Zach tapped the ashes out of his pipe and set it on his pipe stand. He pressed both hands on his desk and stood up. He adjusted his sweater and his saggy gray pants. "Fairies in the poplar," he began again, shaking his head. "What'll they think of next?" Stewie led him out of the cottage and across the meadow of the poplars. He had to stop and wait a few times because Gramp was really slow. They followed the path into the groves and came into a circle of green. Grandpa Zach laughed, and his laugh turned into a cough, as it often did. He cleared his throat and said, "It's just an old golf green, Stewie. The 10th hole, if I'm not mistaken. This whole woods used to be a golf course, you know. I know you've told me the biggest and best golf course in the state." "That's right, built by your great-grandfather, my pop." Grandpa Zach's father, Stuart Ford, had built Westdale Country Club back in the 1930s. Rich people from Minneapolis and St. Paul would drive their fancy cars to play Westdale's tree-lined fairways, its suede-smooth greens, and its white sand bunkers. Gramps had told the story often, but the golf course closed a few years after World War II. "There were 27 greens like in this back in the day, but I imagine the rest of them have all been overgrown. Out in those woods, you might still find a few patches here and there." Grandpa Zach bent down and ran his hand over the grass. "This is a special kind of grass called creeping bent." "Creepy bent? Creeping bent. I like creepy bent better," Stewie said. "It is a little creepy." Gramps stood up, knees cracking, and regarded the white barked trees surrounding them. "It's almost as if they're protecting the green. Poplars like sandy soil, and this green was once surrounded by sand traps. Pop always called them bunkers. You dig down under these trees and you'll find pure white sand trucked all the way in from New Mexico." He shook his head sadly and looked down at the soft green carpet beneath his feet. Now the woods are devouring the past. When I was not much older than you, I used to practice my putting here. Stewie pictured Gramps as a boy standing on this very place. It was so far away, yet so close and real, it sent a shiver up his spine. Times change, Stewie. Before this was a golf course, this was a marsh. You know, Barnett Creek, just north of the highway? Stewie nodded. He and Jack had caught crayfish and tadpoles there. Well, there used to be a branch of the creek that flowed south. Where we're standing now, it was all water, mud, and cattails. Pop dammed up the South Fork back in the 30s and drained the land on this side of the highway. He built our house, the Westdell Country Club. He looked around and with his wistful expression. I don't believe there are any fairies here, Stewie, but there might be a ghost or two. Ghost? Stewie's voice quavered. He didn't really believe in fairies, but he wasn't so sure about ghosts. Grandpa Zach grinned. Gotcha, he said. Stewie grinned back, relieved and feeling kind of silly. Gramps liked to kid around, but suddenly the old man's smile collapsed and he looked away. Do you know what ghosts are, Stewie? I'll tell you. They're secrets haunting the memories of the living. So long as we carry their secrets, they refuse to leave. They wait. Wait for what? To be forgotten. My father has been gone 60 years, but he tapped the side of his head. He's still here. He never left. Oh my goodness. I want to keep reading this book. It is so very good. This one is so great. This one's got ghost in it. It's got some big time fantasy in it that, oh my, you'll have to go watch. I'll link my book talk to it, to the comments in this. Do not miss Otherwood. Let me close out of this real quick so I can stop. Okay, I will see you in the next First Chapter Friday. Bye, guys. See you next time.